The Statue of Liberty has become a symbol of freedom to people from all over the world who have immigrated to this country. Tonight, on the 4th of July and on the 100th birthday of the Statue of Liberty, we have a very touching story to share with you about a young Korean girl who overcame hardship, ridicule, and pain to find a new home for herself in America. Her name is Natasha.
One look at 19-year-old Natasha Driscoll says all American girl. As a freshman at Atlanta's Oglethorpe University, she's popular, she's studious, and she's the yearbook photographer in the center of all campus activity. But the pictures of Natasha's past tell another story. As a child, she was called Un Suk. She was born in Korea, an Amerasian, half Korean, half American.
When I lived in Korea, that I was their friend and everything else, but they knew I was different. You know, I didn't look like one of them.
Un Suk lived in a small village with her grandmother, where she was sheltered from typical prejudice against Amerasians. It was here, at the age of 11, that she was discovered by Rick Smolin, an American photojournalist documenting the plight of Amerasians for Time magazine.
There was something about her which was so different than all the other children. It was the first child I met out of 50 or 60 kids I'd photographed who seemed to have any sense of herself. In fact, she had a very good sense of herself.
Rick spent a week photographing Un Suk, at school, at home, with her grandmother, with her friends.
I ran into her room, she was eating, and I said, look, you know, there's this guy following. I mean, I was just beginning to tell her the story, and in walks Rick. And she didn't even know what was going on, and I just sat there and laughed.
For whatever reason, the Korean society, there's really no place for these children. No one wants to marry them, nobody wants to hire them. I mean, they basically end up in sort of the bad sides of society just because that's the only thing that's left for them to do.
From sunup to sundown, Rick was by Un Suk's side, constantly amazed by her warmth, her strength, and her innocence. At week's end, he knew that saying goodbye would be hard.
The day I was supposed to leave, the grandmother started crying. And I thought I had done something to offend her. So I asked my translator to ask the grandmother why she was crying. And the grandmother said that she thought she was dying and that she was really worried about what would happen to Natasha when she was dead. And she wanted to know if I would take Natasha back to America with me.
As a single man who traveled a lot, Rick knew he couldn't be a parent. But he was so moved by the grandmother's request that he wrote a letter to his friends, Jean and Gail Driscoll, in Atlanta.
Her grandmother said that inevitably the half-American, half-Korean children, no matter how beautiful they may look to an American, are ridiculed and picked on and abused by the other children. As I was reading the letter, about halfway through, I had a feeling what was coming. I knew what he was going to ask us to do.
Before the Driscolls could respond to Rick's letter to tell him they were interested in adopting Un Suk, they received an urgent message.
It was from my office in New York, and it said, someone in Korea has died and left you an 11-year-old girl in their will. Do you know anything about this?
Rick returned to Korea, where he found a sullen Un Suk living with her uncle in Seoul. While the grandmother's request did not legally bind Un Suk to Rick, he was able to convince the uncle that her life would be better in the U.S. So arrangements were made for Un Suk to come to America to live with the Driscoll family.
It was a scary feeling. I really didn't know what to expect. I didn't know anything about the United States.
With hope and determination, Un Suk left her friends and family in Korea and chose what she thought was a common American name, Natasha, to begin her new life. And the Driscolls took on the challenge of making her life a happy one.
And I pointed to a pink strawberry milkshake and she said, yeah. Hot dog and a milkshake was her first fast food meal. It was great.
But the Americanization of Natasha came easier than anyone expected. From her first experience at a YMCA summer camp, just weeks after her arrival in Atlanta, Natasha was on a roll.
We picked her up after the spend the night party. All the girls came out to us and told us that they had crowned her Miss America. And I thought, you know, she's only been here for a month and a half.
Over the next 7 years, with the love and support of her family, Natasha took Atlanta by storm. As a school leader in high school, head cheerleader, and homecoming queen.
I'm very proud of her. I'm not surprised. My feeling that she was special the day I met her has not changed at all. In fact, it's gotten stronger with time.
Rick Smolin, Natasha's life, and she his. Over the years, he has continued to document her. amassing more than 200,000 photographs.
It's a weird feeling. I mean, on the surface, you'd say, well, here are these people, and they've done this nice thing for this little poor little girl. But in fact, we, the three of us, I think, all feel the complete opposite. I mean, she's changed our lives.
There is a magic, because she is such a genuine person.
I want to be a business major, and I want to be able to travel to the different countries and work with foreign cultures.
Natasha Driscoll still holds on to her Korean culture, and within her lies all the warmth and strength of little Eun-suk. But through Rick Samolin and the Driscoll family, she's been able to pursue the American dream.
I'm dying to see what's going to happen to her. In a way, this story never ends. I mean, I hope it never ends.
The next big chapter in Natasha's life will be her return home to visit Korea. She wrote a letter to the Coca-Cola company and told them her story. They, in turn, offered her a job working for Coca-Cola in Korea during the 1988 Olympics, which will be held in Seoul. She's very excited about going home and having a reunion with her aunts and uncles. There's more Evening Magazine coming up. The Phantom Diner has some summertime treats that won't add an inch to your waistline.